Greetings, friends, and welcome back. If you would like, you can mail any offerings to the church at 9 Kapalo Road, or you can drop off any offerings for the church at the Frost Tax Service office in the night drop box. Belinda will get them and make sure that they're recorded and deposited as she normally does. Unfortunately, Rhonda and I will not be at the church on Christmas Eve. We will mail out the sermons for this service to hopefully get to you by then. I pray you all stay home safe. I will be posting a Christmas Eve service around 4 p.m. on the 24th and will be posting a Wellsboro Network joint Longest Night of the Year or Blue Christmas / Advent service on the 21st. We will be back at the church, Rhonda and I will be back at the church on the 27th for our Sunday drive-by service. I know this is not what we were hoping for. I know this is not where we had planned on being, especially for Christmas Eve, but it is where we are. Now, please know that I am available by phone or email if you have a problem, if you need prayer, or if you just want to chat. But now let's take a moment to quietly prepare our hearts and minds for worship. And at this time, let's join the Kotz family as they light our Advent candle.
As we wait for Emmanuel, God with us to arrive, we remember the fears of his earthly parents. We remember the commitment of Joseph. We remember the commitment of Mary.
We remember that the Lord sent angels to comfort and to guide with joy.
In that spirit of joy, of expectation and hope, we light the candle of joy.
Please join us.
Let this fire remind us that while we wait for the Lord, truly the Lord is already here. Hope is here. Love is here. Family is here.
And now please join me in our call to worship. You will read the bold print as it comes on the screen. O come and magnify the Lord. Whether you come to worship, blissful, belligerent, bashful, or abashed. Bring your bodies and brains that bear the burdens of birthing and brokenness. And now, would you read the opening prayer with me? Gracious God, home to the homeless, shelter in times of storms, builder of a city where all are invited to live regardless of socioeconomic status, we call to mind those who have no homes. Our world is busy building more churches, shopping centers, and businesses, while some of your people are still dwelling in proverbial booths. We have built more prisons when you said to set captives free, while some children are building tree houses, the homes others' children know exist only in their dreams. We confess that we have focused on building social programs to fix our faults and remedy those areas where we have been remiss. You, God, are the director of housing of urban development. Give us the tools to build infrastructures and institutions that you will inhabit. Give us the tools to build strong imaginations. Provide the resources to build homes, schools, communities, and futures in which your people can flourish. In the name of the carpenter who makes possible the building of great possibilities. Amen.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O
friends, may the peace of the Lord truly be with you. And now let us worship through our prayer. O come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. God with us, you came to us long ago as a helpless babe, as one in need of human love and care. You taught us how to love and care for one another. Help us to hold on to childlike wonder, amazement, and love, and help us to love one another all year long. Guide our feet into the way of peace, as only the Prince of Peace can lead us, by laying down our lives for one another and serving one another. Now let us pray for God to be with us. Thank you, loving Heavenly Father, for coming with power to the Virgin Mary and making her the mother of our Lord. Come to us with your Holy Spirit so that we receive your saving word and rejoice in our Savior. For he lives with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In the name of Christ, Emmanuel, God with us, we pray. Amen. It's the fourth Sunday of Advent and the tug of war is over. Christmas now takes center stage. We have realized this place is a mess. We've joined the cleanup crew and we've decked the halls. The preparations are made, and now you stand at the door in anticipation of the party attenders arriving, waiting on the threshold. You can't wait. You've done your best. Now whoever comes will be the life of the party, will have the time of their lives. It's hard to contain the joy. Joy, that's the mood of this fourth Sunday of Advent. Now remember, we are of Advent, not in Advent. We don't simply reside in the season, we become it. We exude it, we live it and announce it and celebrate it with every fiber of our being. Company's coming, and we couldn't be more excited. But there are some in our congregation for whom this Sunday message is like Christmas Eve. With our in-person services suspended through this season, we will be missing Thursday evening service, one of our most cherished of services. And we need to hear the promise. We need to remember the hope and how God chose to become flesh and dwell among us so that we could see God's glory. Let us enter into the moment and embrace the gift. Let everyone know that this child has come for them. This salvation has come to their house. This is not a secret we keep to ourselves, hidden behind locked doors. This is news we proclaim from the mountaintops, even if you may come from the flatland. Go up on the mountaintop and proclaim the good news. It's almost Christmas. And we usually hit critical mass somewhere around this last week before the day itself. We run on overload, or we find a little bit of magic, a little miracle working to make it all come out the way we hope and pray that it will. Those seem to be our choices in this season, don't they? Overwhelmed or by the skin of our teeth. Some of you may have noticed that there's a change in the background. As I was at the church filming, the battery ran dead. After running out there and checking to make sure everything was done and meeting Dave as he was finishing cleaning up, and then having to run home and finish the video. Tomorrow, I have my daughter and her boyfriend coming in from New Jersey, and Wednesday, Rhonda and I have to drive to Philly to get our son, who's visiting for the last time before he goes to Korea for 2 years. Now, Thursday night is Christmas Eve, which means I will have a sermon and video ready to go and posted. Now, Friday is Christmas, and then Saturday I have to have another sermon ready to be taped and edited before Sunday. Overwhelmed or by the skin of my teeth? Why? Because it's Christmas. That's the answer we give and we get when we ask, which doesn't really help. It's almost the same as saying, because I said so. Why do we do it? Well, because company's coming and we want the house to look nice. Now that might sound shallow, but it is what motivates us. Appearances. It's not supposed to sound shallow because there's something important going on there. In the desire to present a welcoming home, a home of joy and light, full of the sights and sounds and smells of the season, there's something profound being said about the nature of Christmas itself. Appearances. How would it look if someone showed up before you got everything spruced up? How would it look if you were found with the boxes from the attic not put away and the decorations strewn across the floor and the kitchen a mess because the kids had to help with the baking and the cat knocking the ornaments off the tree with abandon and the tempers running short and the strain beginning to show, and if you push replay on Jingle Bell Rock one more time, I'm not going to be responsible for my actions? How would it look? That was essentially the question that David asks in 2 Samuel. Let's read what happens. So get your Bible and turn to 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 through 11. You can follow along as I read. 2 Samuel chapter 1, chapter 7, starting with verse 1. After the king was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God remains in a tent." Now Nathan replied to the king, "Whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, for the Lord is with you." But that night, the word of the Lord came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell my servant David, this is what the Lord says. Are you the one to build me a house to dwell in? I have not dwelt in a house from the day I brought the Israelites up out of Egypt to this day. I have been moving from place to place with a tent as my dwelling. Wherever I have moved with all the Israelites, did I ever say to any of their rulers whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedar?' Now then, tell my servant David, this is what the Lord Almighty says. I took you from the pasture, from tending the flock, and appointed you ruler over my people Israel. I've been with you wherever you have gone, and I have cut off all your enemies from before you. Now I will make your name great like the names of the greatest men on earth, and I will provide a place for my people Israel and will plant them so that they can have a home of their own and no longer be disturbed. Wicked people will not oppress them anymore as they did at the beginning and have done ever since the time I appointed leaders over my people Israel. I will also give you rest from all your enemies." And verse 16 says, "The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you." So David was relaxing in his lazy boy throne, watching the Philistines losing to the Amalekites in the fourth quarter, and he happens to glance out the window into the backyard, and he sees what God has been living in since he moved back from wherever it was he got stolen to. And he thought, "How does this look? Here I am living in my brand new house with the full finished basement, full baths on every floor, walk-in closet, and three-car garage, and there's God living in a pop-up trailer in my backyard. There's something not right here." Or maybe it was his grumpy wife, Michael, who told him she didn't like the look of God's camper next to her rose bushes, and ever since God strung those lights up on the canopy, it's starting to look like a trailer park out there. David thinks, "How does it look to have me in here and God out there?" Not good, was his conclusion. So David says, "Well, we just got to build God a house." And Nathan, who runs messages back and forth from the camper in the backyard into the palace, says, "Good idea." At least until he trundled out to the backyard and has a word with God. And God says, "No." Says he's kind of partial to the pop-up camper. He likes being able to go where the people are. He likes to be on the move. He doesn't want to be tied down with the maintenance worries that homeownership brings. He prefers to be able to run out in front to head off the bad guys at the pass. And who's the one in the home building business anyway? Wasn't it I who led you home to the promised land? Wasn't it I who made you safe enough to build your tri-level ranch-style palace anyway? I'm the one in the home establishing business, not you. In fact, you might say that's my main motivating factor in all this chosen people stuff in the first place. To make a home. A home for you and my people and through you to make a home for the whole world. Friends, God says, "Come home." That's the offer that God makes to David. Come home. Home to me. Home to your true self. Home to your true family. That's what God is really talking about. Home. David is talking about building a house. And God wants to talk about finding a home. You see, God built in all of us this desire for home. And maybe at Christmas, this desire for home is a little bit stronger or a little bit closer to the surface. And sometimes we have to move heaven and earth to get there. And it upsets our routines, and we will wonder on occasion whether it's worth it. And yet we go, or they come, or we find a new place. God told David that David wasn't going to build God a home. And then it said in the verses we skipped over that David's son was going to do it. And then later, David and everyone thought that God was talking about Solomon, because Solomon did indeed build the temple as a home for God. At least that's what everyone thought God meant. Everyone but Luke, that is. So let's turn to Luke chapter 1 and let's look at verses 46 to 55. Again, you can follow along as I read it. Chapter 1 of the book of Luke, verses 46 to 55, and it starts with, "And Mary said, My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has set the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." You see, Luke reminds us that God had different ideas than the rest of us did. Solomon's temple was quite a structure, and God apparently liked it well enough to visit, but it was never really God's home, or so it seems. And for one thing, it was always called Solomon's temple. No, God had a different son in mind when he said, "Your son will build my home." God was thinking of the one that Gabriel would call the Son of the Most High, the one that would reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there would be no end. That's the son who would build God's home. No one quite got that. David didn't really understand what God meant. Solomon didn't really understand either, but he got the construction crew out anyway. No one knew what God really meant. No one but Mary. But then the indications are that Mary didn't really understand either. I mean, how could she? Just imagine this young, unmarried, soon-to-be-married girl gets a message from God, and the message is, "God's coming home. Take up residence in her." Excuse me? This nothing special backwoods teenager was going to be God's home for a few months. And talk about your troubling house guests. Feet on the furniture are nothing compared to this. Now, those of you who are mothers who have experienced the joy of pregnancy and birth know better than the rest of us the hard realities of this little event. We're here a few days before Christmas talking about Mary finding out she's going to be pregnant, and then Thursday night, she's giving birth. Pretty amazing, really, but not real. She carried this load just like everyone else. She hurt, and she sweated, and she paced, and she groaned, and she struggled, and she wondered, and she worried as she bled, and she gave birth in a barn because no one was willing to give her a bed. Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you. That's how the angel started his conversation with Mary. Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you. The Lord has a different idea of favoritism than we do. The Lord has a different idea of blessing than we do. The Lord has a different idea of home than we do. Come home, says the Lord to us at Christmas time. Come home. David wanted to build a house for God on the tallest hill in Jerusalem, where God could be removed and distant and overlook all the people who would have to go out of their way to give obedience to God. But God wanted to build his home a little closer to the deep realities of living in this world so that we would be surprised by God when we live and where we live. God wanted to build his home where we sweat and labor, where we work and play, where we laugh and cry, where our hearts are lifted up and often broken and sometimes healed. David wanted God's home on a mountain, but God wanted his home in the womb of a virgin, in the feed box behind an inn in the little town of Bethlehem. God wanted his home in the backwoods region of Galilee, on the roads of the countryside, in the grassy place where 5,000 sat and ate their fill. God wanted his home in the birthing units and wedding celebrations and the dinner parties. God wanted his home in the tear-filled bedrooms, in the sick beds, in the COVID units, in the graveyards of his children. God wanted his home in the courtrooms and prison cells, and then on the streets of sorrow of Jerusalem and the dark hill called Calvary. God wants his home in your home, in the living rooms and kitchens and playrooms and bedrooms of your life. God calls to us at Christmas and says, "Greetings, favored ones. I'm coming home for Christmas. Is there room for me in your crowded, busy lives? Is there room for me?" And like any baby born in our midst, he says, "I won't take up much room, just all that you have. Is there room for me? I'm coming home." And off to the side, almost out of our vision, an angel waits for your answer. I'm going home, back to the place where I belong, and where your love has always been enough for me. I'm not running from, I know I think you got me all wrong. I don't regret this life just for me. But these places and these places are getting old, so I'm going home. Let's pray. Holy God, who is active and moving among us, we continue to be surprised at how you are concerned for us. Give us the eyes of faith that we might be surprised by your presence, the ways that you are working within us and within our world this Christmas. Gracious and generous God, we offer our gifts to you, knowing full well we have devoted so much more energy into finding the gifts for our families and much less on the gifts that we offer to you. You gave Mary, an unmarried girl, a son so the world might have a Savior. Her response was so simple: "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be according to your word." May her affirmation of faith and obedience be the gift we offer this day. In Christ we pray. Amen. We are worshipers who expect the impossible. We will conceive possibilities that have yet to be manifest. We can't deny that our lives bear brokenness and beauty. We can't be silent about the Mighty One who has done great things for us. We can't sing the melody of the status quo when God has given us a new song. We will believe that nothing shall be impossible with God. God chose to do the impossible, to become flesh so that you might find life in the flesh possible. May the very ways you live in the world reflect that God is still dethroning the mighty and filling the hungry. Live the song and sing the promises of God's goodness, Christ's coming, and the Spirit's overshadowing. Amen.